You are about to experience Jackson Snyder Presents. We will examine the life of our master, Yashua, by discovering his ancestors, family, and friends, by reviewing rare ancient manuscripts, and speaking to those who know him best. From the Vero Essene Yahad, now experience Jackson Snyder Presents.
Welcome back to Jackson Snyder Presents on Hebrew Nation Radio. This is James and Paul Week. There's a lot that we don't know about James and Paul, but I'm hoping that this session will enlighten you to their lives outside of their letters. Listen to the whole series. You might be very surprised, perhaps shocked, by what you learn about James and Paul outside of their letters. In this session, we're going to introduce to you James the Just, or Yaakov HaZadik, the brother of Messiah. We know a lot about him from both secular history and religious history, and we need to know more. Too many believers don't know a thing about James. I'm going to start with a couple of passages from Scripture. First of all, Acts 15:12. And all the assembly kept silence, and they listened to Barnabas and Paul as they related what signs and wonders Elohim had done through them among the Gentiles. After they finished speaking, James replied, "Brethren, listen to me." And the second passage is from the Epistle of James 5:6. "You have condemned, you have killed the just one. He does not resist you." In Acts 15, we have what's been described as the first council of the Assembly of Yahweh, which took place in Jerusalem sometime in the fourth decade of the first century. Appearing before the assembled elders are Paul and Barnabas, giving their account of the outpouring of the Spirit among the Gentiles, and begging the council to give them approval for their work. The question Paul brings the council is, "What yoke are we to put upon the necks of the Gentiles, seeing as how they are already saved by the favor of Master Yeshua?" Answer is made to this question by Yaakov, whom I will refer to as James from now on, the brother of Yeshua, who says, "Brothers, listen to me." We can well imagine that his voice is the voice of authority as he goes on to make his judgment in the case, and his judgment is primarily that the Gentiles are to keep the food ordinances and the Shabbatot until they learn the more advanced ways of the Nazarene Ebionite faith. This council of the assembly comes as the result of a dispute in Antioch earlier among the brethren, described firsthand by Paul in his letter to the Galatians. He says that Jew and Gentile believers were having table fellowship when a group came from James in Jerusalem to observe what was happening. Paul calls this the circumcision party. And at their approach, the Jews, including Peter, got up from the table and left the Gentiles reclining there alone. Of course, prior to this Antiochian fellowship, Jews didn't eat with Gentiles, believers or not. And it's clear in the Nazarene Acts of the Apostles that Jewish disciples continued not to eat with Gentiles until they were fully proselytized into the community of faith through the washing of baptism. The reason for this separation is also revealed in the Nazarene Acts. Anyway, Paul rails against Peter when he, along with Barnabas and the rest of the Jewish believers, get up from the table and join the circumcision party apart. Then Paul makes religious history by writing the whole story up and circulating it, and in it Paul refers sarcastically to James as one of those who were reputed to be something, but they have nothing over me. In this extremely candid second chapter of Galatians, we learn that not everything was as rosy in the movement as Luke records in the Acts. Paul's vitriol nearly drips from the page. Furthermore, If we put parts of the letter of James and Paul's letter to the Galatians in parallel columns, we come to conclude that James was written first and that Paul is replying to James and making commentary on James' letter. And most of that commentary Paul makes is to criticize and contradict James on just about every point, especially in regards to James' insistence upon a judgment of works in accordance with the Torah. The whole story of the conflict in Antioch got back to James quickly and set up the circumstances for the Jerusalem Council that I've already mentioned, which I suppose was not the tidy, innocuous affair recorded by the historian of Acts. The tension and friction between James and Paul is so obvious that most conservative preachers have to either admit it or ignore it completely. I'm not afraid of bringing it up because there's a great deal to be learned from this conflict, and just as obvious, if anyone will read the scriptures critically, is the immense power that James had in the First Assembly, even to the overruling of both Peter and Paul in matters of faith. The strange thing is that we don't find James, the brother of Yahshua, formally introduced anywhere in the scriptures until Acts 15, when all of a sudden he makes binding decisions upon the assembly, not only in Jerusalem, but in the whole known world. Yes, it's very strange that we know nothing about the leader of the movement before this. So, who is this James, and why don't we as Neo-Nazarenes know anything about him? Why is his history censored in the New Testament? Don't you think it's important to learn the ways and means of the one who was actually in charge of the entire ministry after his brother left? Of course it is. And that's the purpose of this essay, to introduce James the Just, known in antiquity as Yaakov HaTzadik, the brother of Yahshua HaMoshiach. The reason James is nearly absent from the historical books of the New Testament is that most of the New Testament is pro-Paul. And Paul's theology of being justified not through righteous actions, as James taught, but through faith in the favor of the one he called Christos, Jesus, won out by the time the New Testament took its present form. Though James won the Battle of Antioch, calling believers back to the Torah, Paul won the war of the world through the Gentile mission, and by the 4th century, Paul's way was the only way, with the Gentile theologians of the day decrying the Nazarene way of James as a vile heresy, and the Nazarene faith going underground to avoid Christian persecution. The funny thing is that these 4th and 5th century heresiologists admitted that the first believers, apostles, and disciples were Nazarenes and Ebionites, but they still decry these movements to be godless heresies because they relied on the Torah. If these churchmen are understood in the fullest manifestation, that is, as Reformed theologians, they would say that Torah keeping is a sin unto death because to keep any part of the law was to distrust the favor of Christos Jesus. This understanding is derived in part from an unsound reading of Galatians 5:2-4. Now I, Paul, say to you that if you receive circumcision, Christos will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who receives circumcision that he is bound to keep the whole Torah. You are severed from Christos, you who would be justified by the Torah, you have fallen away from favor. Passages like this make it all the more important that we have honest, though not necessarily popular, scripture translators in our movement, because there is some problems with the translation here. As Nazarenes of these latter days, we should be looking to James as our primary Sholiach, apostle, rather than Paul, for we live far more like James taught the Jews, as the successor to Yahshua, than Paul taught the Gentiles. The fact is, you and I are not Gentiles anymore, but we have become as much as of the circumcision party, the party of James, as Paul calls it, as the first followers of Messiah were. Are we not of the circumcision? Look at your pickle. Yes, we are. Then let's follow James. And there's the problem. In order to follow him, first we have to find him, for we can only find a small part of him in the New Testament, and in there, his life story is concealed. Fortunately, outside the New Testament, there's a lot of ancient biographical material that can help us in our quest for the historical James. Did you know that James' genealogy on both sides is found in the New Testament? Where? Matthew 1 and Luke 3. James is the son of Joseph and Maria, which puts him in the line of both David and Zadok and makes him a candidate not only for the king of Israel, but also for the high priesthood. He is set apart for rulership and ministry from his birth, a lifelong Nazarite, a vegetarian who also abstained from intoxicating drink of any kind, and James, in accordance with the vow in Bamidbar 6, didn't cut his hair. This means he was dedicated to Yahweh and Torah his whole life, and became a man as close to scriptural holiness as humanly possible, to be a beacon for the zealous of the people and emulate the condition of his brother Yahshua. James owns a house close to the temple, and it was his habit to enter the temple daily to pray for the absolution of the sins of the people, so much so that he has the knees of a camel from staying on them for so long a time. There might well be another reason for him having the knees of a camel, for in the Nazarene Acts of the Apostles, there is recorded James' first experience with Paul. It reports James' habit of teaching daily upon the steps of the temple, himself sitting on the higher step, while his Nazarene sat below where they could see and hear better. One day, Paul and his group of vigilantes approaches James' group, and as loud as he can, Paul calls for the death of James and the Nazarenes, hoping to get some volunteers to do his dirty work. Thereupon, the James gang is attacked on those steps, and Paul casts James headlong down the steps, breaking his legs. James is left for dead, but his followers escape with him back to his house. From here, James and 5,000 followers leave Jerusalem to sit out this persecution in the wilderness, while Paul and his vigilantes head out on the Damascus Road. This may explain why James had deformed knees, just as well as his kneeling in prayer. Sometime later, after Paul has a religious experience on the Damascus Road, he tells us that he made a trip to Jerusalem to see Peter, and there he saw James, the master's brother, again. Had he not been such a brave man, James would have been terrified at such a visit. What will he break next? Will he take my life? Paul doesn't say anything about this meeting, no comment. But I think Paul must have come to survey James' deformed legs, make a fervent apology, and offering to assist him any way he could. That would be a mission of a good man. That James succeeded Yahshua is recorded in several sources. In one very early source, the Talmudim, that is, disciples, ask Yahshua who is to succeed them when he goes away. Yahshua says, "Go to James the Just, for whom Shamayim and Eretz came to be." That is, heaven and earth. Yahshua calls him the Just, which is, in Hebrew, of course, HaZadik, because he was considered a righteous priest of Yahweh within the Yahad and for the people of Yahweh throughout the world. Each Yahad has at least three priests, and according to Scripture, James was the chief priest of the Nazarene movement at the time. His fellow priests, according to Paul, are Kephas and Yochanan, John. The description, "for whom heaven and earth came to be," is a prophetic designation regarding James as a pillar of Israel, and that if the pillar falls from righteousness, the whole identity of Israel would also fall. James is called the Mevaker of Mevakarim, that is, the overseer of overseers, or in churchy language, bishop of bishops. He's called that by Kepha, Peter, who indicates that all official correspondence and all leadership within the Nazarene faith was to go through James, and Kepha gives over all his writings to James for safekeeping in fear that false Kephas, false Peters, would disseminate false teaching in his name. James and his successors, with his library of apostolic writings, would then be able to validate any Nazarene teaching by comparing it with the genuine writings held in his trust. Today, some of these original writings are available, but not in the Bible. They have been edited out by the Latin Church. It should be part of our mission to recapture genuine apostolic teaching and we're trying hard to do so by putting out many volumes of this genuine material. But unfortunately for Christianity, not too many are interested in going beyond their King James versions of the New Testament. One thing we learn from this one-time enemy, Paul, is that the risen Yahshua appeared to James. There are several lengthy accounts of the risen Yahshua's counsel with James outside the New Testament, one of which elucidates the Emmaus walk narrative from Luke 24. In that account, Cleopas, who is the brother of Yahshua we know as Shimon, and another disciple, who is James, interesting how the gospel editor disguises the names, they're walking toward Emmaus when they encounter an unrecognized man who begins to exegete the scriptures to the brothers James and Shimon. When they get a hotel, they order some bread, and Yahshua is recognized in the breaking of the bread. And here we have three brothers reclining at the dinner table, Yahshua, Yaakov, and Shimon, and one of them has just risen from the dead. Another source tells us that the reason for the bread is that James had vowed not to eat anything until he met his brother risen from the dead. When Yahshua broke the bread, according to this account, he didn't disappear as he did in Luke, but he says to James, "My brother, eat your bread, for the Son of Man is risen from the dead." And the writer of this account continues by telling us that after this, James ruled the assembly of Yahweh for the next 30 years. And indeed, history tells us that James was the head of the worldwide movement from 33 AD until his martyrdom in 62 AD. Now, the historian Josephus, he implies that since the days of the Maccabees up until the end of the temple, the thousands of zealots were in the custom of electing their own popular high priest, and that this priest was permitted to go into the Kadosh Kadoshim, the Holy of Holies, each Yom Kippur, to plead for atonement on behalf of those who elected him. Now, there are four implications to the election of a popular high priest, an opposition high priest, as distinguished from the appointed one. First, there was a high priesthood of the people in competition with the appointed priests, and second, that the zealots were on a different calendar than the status quo. How else could they access the Kadosh at the appointed time if they were on the same calendar? And third, that the zealots didn't consider the appointed priests as from the right families, and fourth, that the appointed priests were simply not righteous enough to carry out efficacious prayers and sacrifices. Hegesippus, a 2nd century Nazarene, tells us that James was the popular priest given the opportunity each year to enter into the Kadosh Kadoshim to make intercession for the people. He wore the white linen of a holy man, just like the Essenes, just like the priests, just like the set-apart Kadoshim, described in Acts 1:10 and Revelation 7:9. And Hegesippus adds that this is why he was called the Just, because he was a Nazarite, wore the white linen, was of the house of Zadok the priest, a Melchizedek priest, and was one of the most righteous men of his time. And into the sanctuary he was permitted to go. Paul never knew Yahshua and speaks very little about him, but James was his brother, and few are closer than a brother. To learn of James' high status makes us want to investigate the lives of Yahshua's other brothers and sisters. That might be the subject for the next time, but now we turn to James' martyrdom. It will be no surprise to you who his murderers turn out to be. At least three early historians tell us about James' death: Josephus, Eusebius, and Hegesippus. I'm going to read you an excerpt of the latter's testimony, which I have edited for language and a little content out. "As there were many of the rulers that believed through the testimony of James, there arose a furor among the Jews, scribes, and Pharisees, saying that there was danger that the people would now expect Yahshua to come as the Messiah. So they came together and said to James, "We beg you to hold down the people who are led astray after Yahshua, as if he were the Anointed One. We beg you to persuade all that are coming to the feast of the Passover rightly about Yahshua, for we all have confidence in you. For we and all the people bear the testimony that you are just, and you do not respect persons. So persuade the people not to be led astray by Yahshua. For we and all the people have great confidence in you. Stand on the wing of the temple, so you can be seen, and your words easily heard by all. For all the tribes have come together for Passover, with some of the Gentiles also." So the scribes and Pharisees put James on the wing of the temple and cried out to him, "O you just man, whom we should all believe, since the people are led astray after Yahshua, who was crucified, tell us now, what is the gate to Yahshua that was crucified?" Then James answered with a loud voice, "Why do you ask me about Yahshua, the Son of Man? He is now sitting in the skies, on the right hand of the great power, and is about to come on the clouds." And by this many were confirmed in their faith at James' testimony, and said, "Hosanna to the Son of David!" But the same priests and Pharisees said to one another, "Oh, we've done wrong in allowing this testimony. So let's go up and throw James down, that the people will dread to believe in him." So the scribes and Pharisees cried out, "No, the Just One himself is deceived." And they fulfilled what is written in Isaiah, "Let us take away the Just One, because he is offensive to us." So going up, they cast down the just man. Then they said to one another, "Let us stone James the Just." And they began to stone him. See, as he did not die immediately when thrown down, but turning round, he knelt there praying, "I beg you, O Yahweh Elohim and Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." While they were stoning him, one of the Rechabite priests cried out, "What are you doing? Stop! The Just One is praying for you." And one of them, a fuller, beat out the brains of the Just One with the club that he used to beat out clothes. And James became a faithful witness, both to the Jews and Greeks, that Yahshua is the Anointed One. Immediately after this, Vespasian invaded and took Judea. Notice here at the end how Hegesippus connects the death of the Just One with the invasion of the Romans. This is because when this Zadok falls, Israel falls with him. And Israel did indeed fall over the next 7 years. It's obvious to me, and maybe to you now, that James was censored by the editors of the New Testament in favor of Paul. Whether this is because James was just, too holy, or too Hebrew, or too Jewish, or too Torah-oriented, or to save his family from further persecution and assassination, I don't know. But I do know that we should recover the historical James, if for no other reason than where you find the historical Yaakov, James, you also find the historical Yahshua. Jackson Snyder. We're going to take a little break now to present some very important messages, but we will be right back here on Hebrew Nation Radio.
Wisdom.
You are about to experience Jackson Snyder Presents. We will examine the life of our Master Yahshua by discovering his ancestors, family, and friends, by reviewing rare ancient manuscripts, and speaking to those who know him best. From the Pharaoh Yahad at YAHAD.US, now experience Jackson Snyder Presents.
Greetings. This is Jackson Snyder of JacksonSnyder.org, and the title of this essay is The Messianic Revolution and the Third Way. Submit yourselves to Elohim. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. James 4:7. Unless your righteousness be more abundant than that of the Sofrim and Prushim, you can by no means enter into the Malkuth Shamayim. Matthew 4:20. If you had the opportunity to beam back 2,000 years and spend a year in Galilee finding and following Yahshua, what would you need to learn in the 3 months prior to your journey? Think. And what 5 things would you make sure to take with you? Think. I would surely give you a saddle and a donkey, but I would take with me a pocket full of silver coins and a pistol, and I'll tell you why I would take my pistol. We imagined that it would be rather peaceful leading our donkeys through the calm and fertile land of Israel, enjoying good weather, colorful characters, worshipful experiences, and lots of homemade bread. And of course, meeting the Yahshua of history, eye to eye. But you might be surprised to learn that instead of a lazy, peaceful sojourn, we would more probably be subjected to grave danger constantly. Galilee was under the rule of a murdering autocrat, Herod Antipas, who was in turn under the thumb of an insane despot, Tiberius Caesar. The powerful used their influence to enrich themselves at the expense of the poor, as we read in the Epistle of James. Those who were not powerful were undercut at every turn, and those who had just a little were taxed into poverty. The priestly families in Jerusalem were interested solely in preserving their own resources, and they partnered themselves with the marauding bands of thieves and murderers that scoured the land for victims. Your trek into Galilee would be fraught with danger, especially considering that you would be a total stranger and neither Greek nor Jew. And this is why I would take a pistol. Galilee's population was 2/3 Greeks and foreigners, and the Israelites, making up the 1/3, were not all that popular with the majority. We get the impression from the New Testament that the Sadducees were the real rulers and administrators of the Torah, and the Pharisees comprised the popular movement of the people back toward morality and unity. However, this too is to be questioned. Josephus tells us that, by the days of Yahshua, a new movement was sweeping Palestine, an explosion of zeal for the Torah that he called the Innovation. This innovation is put into the mouth of James the Just by the writer of Acts in this quote: "You see, brethren, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed. They are all zealous for the Torah." That's in Acts 21:20. We call this innovation the Zealot Movement, or more descriptively, the Messianic Movement. They're both the same thing. And it's to this association that we claim fellowship yet today, as we call our assemblies Yahadim, the very same term as the Zealots used. Now, the Zealot movement is not to be confused with the Sicarii, who used murder as a means to advance their political agenda. Messianic Zealots lived strictly by Torah. They didn't do murder. Messianic Zealots were a threat to all those who were in power, for it was the intent of the Messianic movement to rob the powerful of their power through Torah and give it back to the Almighty and His Messiah. Now that we've established that Messianics were zealots for the Torah, and that we are modern-day Messianics, that is, much closer to the original movement than any other group on earth today, we might want to define ourselves in terms of being polar opposite to more static religions of yesteryear. I'm speaking of Phariseeism, or first century rabbinical Judaism, a movement that's still very powerful and influence upon us today. Pharisees and Messianics had some major differences. There are two primary characteristics of first century rabbinical Judaism that made them successful enough to survive the fall of Jerusalem and persist into the latter day. These characteristics are accommodation and elaboration. In order to keep their esteem and power, the Pharisees accommodated the Sadducees, accommodated the Herodians, and accommodated the Romans any time that the latter's whims crossed the Pharisaical view of the Torah. They accommodated the powers most often by elaborating on the Torah, changing it, adding to it, taking away from it, to stay out of conflict with their rivals, as evidenced by the body of literature that became known even in their time as the Mishnah, or Oral Torah. However, as an old movement, on the whole, they would not compromise or accommodate the upstart Messianics any more than Paul, a Pharisee, would compromise with James, a Nazarene, as evidenced in the Epistle of the Galatians. Unlike the Pharisees, the Messianic zealots didn't accept the notion of oral Torah, and we do not accept it yet today. Jerome, a 4th-century Roman Christian and Bible translator, lived in Israel, and he knew the early Nazarenes. In a very rare text, Jerome presents us with 5 commentaries on Isaiah that he says are from the Yahad of the Nazarenes. The commentaries are all fascinating, and I'll share one with you now that will demonstrate just how deep was the divide between the Nazarene zealotry and rabbinical Judaism in the first few hundred years. Jerome writes about the Nazarene concept of the two houses this way. The Nazarenes, who accept Messiah in such a way that they do not cease to observe the old law, explain the two houses as the two families, that is, of Shammai and Hillel, from whom originated the scribes and the Pharisees. Understand that Shammai was the leading voice of the scribes, and Hillel was the leading voice of the Pharisees. Both are revered in Judaism and even in the modern Nazarene movement. Jerome continues with the Nazarene commentary with these words. Shammai, then Hillel, were born long before the Master. They originated in Judea. The name of the first means scatterer, and the second means unholy, because he scattered and denied the precepts of the Torah by his traditions and Mishnah. And these are the two houses who did not accept the Savior, who became to them destruction and shame. And I end the quote there. Understand that the Nazarenes are talking about the scribes and the Pharisees, the followers of their forebears, Shammai and Hillel. Obviously, these two Jewish philosophers were not hallowed in the original assembly as we hallow them today. Their destruction and shame predicted by the Nazarenes were not in the natural. Both houses, Shammai and Hillel, continued to thrive right up to the present day. But that in the eyes of the Father of Messiah, these movements were double dead then, and rabbinical and ultra-Orthodox Judaism, their offspring, without Yeshua HaMashiach, are just as dead today. Had we been followers of Yeshua in those days, we would notice the constant harassment of the houses of Shammai and Hillel against the Messianic believers to the extent of the cutting off of heads, the casting off from the temple parapet, and the stoning of the righteous. It's amazing to me that Latter-day Nazarenes are so enamored and obsessed with the Judaism that decimated their forebears, while at the same time they stubbornly remain so plumb ignorant of their own history. Are we just Christians with Jewish aspirations, or are we real, historical, Messianic Nazarenes? If we are the latter, shouldn't we know something of the primitive Nazarene movement? Why, yes, we should. It's my intention to give you some contextual knowledge about the way Yeshua and his Yahad thought in contradiction to the accommodative and elaborative ways you've heard. Yeshua's way was not the path of either Shammai or Hillel. If we count the ways of the scribes and Pharisees as way one and way two, then Yeshua's way was original and different. It was a third way, a Messianic's way, a zealot's way. As we advance in the scripture toward Matthew 22, the chapter in which Yeshua answers the question, what is the great commandment of the Torah, we encounter his testing by his foes. In chapter 21, the chief priests and Pharisees are displeased with his behavior, and they want to arrest him. while the elders demand that he prove his credentials authorizing him to address the people in the first place. Then in chapter 22, the Pharisees send the Herodians and their disciples in to question him. Then the Sadducees test him on his view of the resurrection of the dead. Next, a Torah expert chimes in to ask him, what is the great commandment? Next comes the Pharisees again, testing him on his messianic identity. These foes all want this messianic out of the way. The provocation continues into Matthew 23, when finally Yeshua tells us why he can listen to what these foes say, but not do as they do. It's because they talk, but do not walk, and they demand service, but do not serve. After this, in Matthew chapter 23, 15 and following, Yeshua just lets the followers of Shammai and Hillel have it. You scribes and Pharisees, pretenders, you cross sea and land to make a single convert, and when he becomes a convert, you make him twice as much a child of Gehenna as yourselves. Look, this is a scathing judgment against pretenders, against scribes, Pharisees, Herodians, Sadducees, Hillel, and Shammai, and all their disciples. And all of Jerome's Nazarene commentaries are right in line with this thinking, even a couple hundred years after the fact. Indeed, Yeshua has a third way of seeing Torah and its required behavior, and he demonstrates for us a way to express Torah that's not elaborative, like the scribes, not accommodating, like the Pharisees, but revolutionary, clever, and practical, especially for those of us who are out of power, those of us who are indebted, poor, and overly criticized for holding firm to the original Nazarene, messianic, zealous for Torah faith. One of the most obvious examples of Yahshua's third way is in his answer to the question, what is the great commandment of the Torah? It goes almost without saying now that his summing up of the entire Torah with, you will love Yahweh with your whole heart, then summing it up a second time with, you will love your neighbor as yourself, was revolutionary at the time, so much so that his answer was later attributed to Hillel in the Mishnah. In Matthew 21 through 23, there are several other amazing instances of the third way, and they're so obvious that I need not go into them now other than to remind you to give Caesar Caesar's and Elohim Elohim's. I would instead like to demonstrate for you three examples in the Sermon on the Mount that were once revolutionary, but now are taken by Nazarenes to be elaborative, accommodative, and extraordinarily passive. If you have your scripture, turn over to Matthew chapter 5, starting at verse 20. You can stop this recording until you get there. It says there, Yahshua is speaking, for I say to you, except your Zedekah shall exceed the Zedekah of the Sofrim and Prushim, you shall in no case enter into the Malkut HaShamayim. We have been taught that righteousness has very little to do with rightness. That if we just love on each other and expect extraordinary grace, if we'll only be ecumenical and open, then we can't help but be righteous before Elohim, because Elohim is love. But to me, this Christian idea is just unreasonable. How can we possibly be practicing scriptural holiness and righteousness if we're wrong in the first place? How can that love and feeling be right if we are, at our intellectual core, dead wrong? How can our righteousness exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees if we who have wits about us are not accurate as to why we do what we do, why we believe what we believe? We might as well remain liberal Christians and make it easy on ourselves. You can hardly hold a modicum of righteousness without also holding a modicum of rightness. This is what Yeshua means when he says to be perfected unto your Abba and the Shamayim. Not be perfected unto scribes and Pharisees, Jews or Gentiles, rabbis, Hebrew roots teachers, preachers, ancient or modern. Not to be perfected unto accommodation, elaboration, or ecumenicism. To be righteous then is to know, then say, and do what is right and just. But first, one must seek to know what is right. With that said, let us now rightly reinterpret a few of Yahshua's sayings in the light of his third way, starting with the saying in Matthew 5:39. So I say to you, that you resist not evil. Not resisting the evil man is neither right nor just. Let me contradict. Not resisting evil is neither right nor righteousness. Not resisting is not righteousness, and lack of word or action in the presence of the evil is certainly not a step on the way to perfection. You may ask, isn't that what it plainly says, don't resist evil? The answer is, no, the word doesn't say that at all. It says exactly the opposite. When we look at the Greek, me antistenai tu ponero, means do not uphold the evil man. Antistenai in this case means uphold or sustain, not resist. It should be do not uphold the evil man. King James translators made sure to mistranslate the words me antistenai from not uphold to not resist in order to uphold the monarchical power of the king and his lords. They elaborated on the word of Yahshua so that those who read it would be more accommodating to the inequitable political system. I'm sorry to tell you that the King James Version is full of such mistranslations and additions, and unfortunately, scripture translators have followed suit in order to accommodate the popularity of this 400-year-old version and uphold the political power politics of all Christian cultures since. But this is an error. Friends, take the third way. Let's not uphold man's evil, nor the evil man or woman. Let us resist evil in the wisest and most beguiling way that we can. Yahshua gives us examples of this kind of wise resistance in verses 39b through 41. But in order to understand these correctly, we must know the context. So let us now get on with the messianic revolution in the third way in verse 39b. Whoever shall smite you on your right cheek, turn to him the other one also. How is this example not upholding the evil man? If you read the Dead Sea Scrolls, you know that people in that day reserved their left hand for toileting. They didn't bring the left hand out. To strike you on the right cheek with the right hand would require the striker to backhand you, an action reserved for slaves and inferiors. Romans did strike Jews at the back of the hand and upon the Jews' right cheek. Men did slap their wives with the back of the hand and on the right cheek, and sometimes wives slapped their husbands. Yahshua is speaking to those who are used to being degraded, saying, refuse to accept this kind of evil treatment anymore. Turn to them the left cheek. Now, in doing this, the victim makes it physically impossible to be struck with another backhand and begs the brute to strike with a right fist instead. The problem for the evil striker is that striking with the right fist is reserved for equals only. A Roman soldier would never strike a Jew on the left cheek with his right fist. It would denote equality. In turning the cheek this way, the victim is saying, I won't be your victim. I am your equal. I demand respect, even if you have to hit me with your fist. The Jew might then be delivered up to be flogged, but he would keep his dignity intact, and he would have resisted evil in perhaps the only equitable way that he possibly could. Yahshua is therefore saying, find a third way that is neither submission nor reprisal, neither accommodation or elaboration, and not like the scribes and Pharisees. You who would be victims, resist the evil man and retain your dignity. Next, in verse 40, and if any man will sue you at the court and takes away your coat, let him have your cloak also. Now this should read, if a man wins your clothes, give him your underpants too. When there was nothing left to take from a debtor, the court could award the creditor the debtor's clothes in lieu of payment on the condition that the clothes were given back at sunset so the debtor would have something to sleep in. Then at dawn, the debtor could again take the creditor's garment away and continue this cycle day in, day out until the debt was paid, which often was never. While the creditor held the clothes, he could do anything he wanted with them, like use them to strain sewage, just as long as they were back in the hands of the debtor at sunset. Now, this condition of extreme poverty was common at the time due to the heavy taxes levied on common people and interest on land that often exceeded 100%. Else, Yahshua would never have brought it up in the first place. He tells them that, while in the courtroom, once they are judged for their clothes, they should strip themselves naked before everyone there who was a part of such a demeaning process. According to Torah, shame doesn't fall upon the naked person, but upon those who witness the nakedness. The judge and the creditor are cursed, just like Ham and Canaan in Genesis 9. Imagine this kind of shame. The wealthy creditor standing in court with his victim's clothes in one hand and his underpants in the other, while the debtor stands stark naked before the whole court. Though he has no possibility of winning the case, he says, "You have my clothes, you have my underpants, all I have left is my skin. Go ahead, make my day." Thus the creditor, powerless and naked, turns the tables upon the powerful, evil man, and gains respect among his neighbors, most of which are just as poor and powerless. The third way catches on among the rest of the debtors in court. Then you have a righteous revolution. Yahshua is again saying to the poor, "Find a dignified way that is neither submission nor reprisal, neither accommodation nor elaboration." And perhaps the rich and powerful will be shamed into Teshuvah and Yeshua. Finally, we're on to verse 41. "And whoever shall compel you to go a mile, go with him too." It was the common practice of Roman foot soldiers to impress Jews to carry their backpacks, which weighed 85 pounds or more before weapons. We remember that Romans impressed Simon of Cyrene to take up the torture stake of Messiah on the Via Dolorosa. That was within their legal power. Whole villages would disappear when the soldiers came through in order to avoid having to carry the soldiers' stuff. Impressing civilians was such a common practice that Roman law limited its use, allowing the soldier to impress the Jew with a pack for one stadia, that is about 500 feet, only. If a citizen was impressed to go further, he could complain to the centurion, who would then issue a punishment against the offending soldier, a punishment in the form of a flogging, humiliation, or latrine duty. No soldier would be comfortable not knowing what his punishment might be for passing the one stadia limit. No soldier wanted to be impressed himself for a severe beating or guarding toilets all night. Punishment was at the sole discretion of the centurion, and by and large, these men were brutal. Again, Yahshua proves a third way, a messianic way, a revolutionary way, for one so subjected to keep his dignity in the face of such humility and degradation by a foreign power. "If you're impressed into the service by the Roman army," he implies, "don't give up the soldiers' things after one stadia. Just keep on walking as far as you can." Yahshua neither accommodates the soldier nor elaborates on the law. He doesn't say, "Make friends," or "Repeat the sinner's prayer," or "Stick a shank in his ribs." He just says, "Go a second." Thus, more uncertainty for the powerful. Does this Jew know the rules of impression? "Certainly not. He's so cheerfully slaving over my stuff. But how can I be sure?" Oh, what the heck. Carry on, Jew. And through his third messianic way, the power now belongs to the slave. His dignity is kept intact, and he may pursue equitable justice of the centurion if he wants to. There are many more examples of the third way, but these make my point. Unless we make an effort to leave the scribes and Pharisees behind and rediscover our historical Nazarene roots, we'll be at a loss to properly understand any words of the apostolic prophets. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we knew about the movers and shakers of the Nazarene messianic and zealot faith and could celebrate them during the feast? Yes, it would be great. In my next speech, I'll introduce to you who I believe is the greatest Sholiach, the greatest apostle who ever lived, James the Just, and we'll have another opportunity, of which I hope there will be many in the future, to explore our unique Nazarene roots of faith. Amen. Until then, this is Jackson Snyder, jacksonsnyder.org.
You have been experiencing Jackson Snyder Presents on the Hebrew Nation radio station. Join us again tomorrow for another exciting revelation of the biblical historical faith. Historical faith. Historical faith. Historical faith. You are about to experience Jackson Snyder Presents. We will examine the life of our Master Yeshua by discovering his ancestors, family, and friends, by reviewing rare ancient manuscripts, and speaking to those who know him best. From the Vero Essene Yahad, now experience Jackson Snyder Presents.
Welcome! Welcome to the Vero Yahad here in sunny Florida. Not so sunny tonight. It's raining and it's supposed to get down to 50 degrees tomorrow. Think of that. I mean, that's really cold for around here with all this rain and all. I expect there'll be lots of traffic accidents. So while you're suffering up there in the snow, you think about us and pray for us and our safety down here. Let us pray right now. Father Yahweh Elohim, we bless your name tonight. We bless you for being with us and taking part in these studies with us. Each one here, I pray for a special anointing that they might go forth in what they have learned and that they might be able to help convict and convince a lost world, be salt and light to that world, and come into the fullness of understanding of your kingdom and your new way in this new millennium. We pray these things in the name of Yahshua HaMashiach, our Savior. Amen. Notice how when you go to church, the minister always pauses after the prayer for a pregnant moment. I'm having mine right now. The only legitimate high priests under the economy of Yahweh were those who were of the house of Zadok. Zadok meaning primarily the high priest in the time of David and Solomon. But in order to show you that, and I've got to show you the legitimate priesthood before I can show you the opposition priesthood, we've got to go way on back. So we've got to go back as far as the celebrated priest of El Elyon, the Most High El Melchizedek, and that is in Genesis 14, 17 that I am speaking about. And I'll just read a couple of verses here. After his, that is Abram's or Avram's, return from the defeat of Kedorlaomer, I'm looking at this darn ISR scriptures, Kedorlaomer, and the sovereigns who were with him, the sovereign of Sodom, came out to meet him in the valley of Shaweh. Shaweh, that is the sovereign's valley. And Melchizedek, sovereign of Shalom, brought out bread and wine. Now, he was the priest of the most El Elyon. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Avram, our El Elyon, possessor of the heavens and the earth. And blessed be El Elyon, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And Avram gave him a tenth of all. What the tenth means in this particular case, up and above the pecuniary or the amount of spoils that was received by Melchizedek, it verified Avram's acceptance of Melchizedek as a priest. Now, understand, Melchizedek is not a name. It's become a name to us because there is some misunderstanding about the priesthood in those early days. We've got to parse it a little bit, and I know you already know that Melchi is, well, it's been translated as king, but it really means leader or ruler, and Zadik or Zedek is righteousness. Understand that ZDK, Zedek, and Zadok are exactly the same word in Hebrew. This is before, long before the vowel points. So it's hard to really say that they're different, except if we believe the Masoretes and all, they're different. But it is in circles that understand this priesthood, the name is actually translated. The leading Zadok, okay, the leading Zadok, Melchizedek. Zadok, meaning righteousness, was a celebratory name for each high priest of the dynasty. When the man became a priest, his name became Righteous, or he would take his first name and add to that the name Zadok. Righteous. So the leadings of Zadok, that is Melchizedek, as we call him, was a Jebusite priest. He was there in the little kingdom of Shalom or Salem, and the king of what became Yerushalayim later on. And when the Davidic dynasty took power over Jebus or Jebus, as we say in the King James language, David inherited the Melchizedek. He inherited the priest of Jebus. And so we find Zadok following on from Melchizedek unto the kingship or rulership of David, him being the leading Zadok, or in other words, what we call the Kohen HaGadol, or the high priest. We go to 2 Samuel 8:16, and, oh, I should have got out of Revised Standard. This ISR is hard for me to read. And Joab, son of Zeruiah, was over the army. And Jehoshaphat, son of Ahilud, was recorder. And Zadok, son of Ahitub, and Ahimelech, son of Ebiathar. Do I ever have this trouble pronouncing these names, Commander?
Not at all.
Never.
Well,
just your name. Over both the Kerethites and the Pelethites, and David's sons were also priests. So we find that Zadok, that leading Zadok, in that company in 2 Samuel as the prophet lays out for us some of the leading members of David's cabinet. So we find that Zadok remained faithful to David through several coup attempts, including those two or three coup attempts by his own sons, and through betrayals by relatives, and through betrayals by priests. Look at 1 Kings 1:38, an important notice here. Then Zadok the priest, and Natan the prophet, and Benaiahu, son of Jehoiada, and the Kerethites, and the Pelethites went down and had Shlomo ride on sovereign David's mule and took him to Gihon. And Zadok the priest took a horn of oil from the tent and anointed Shlomo, that of course is Solomon. And they blew the horn, and all the people said, "Let sovereign Shlomo live." So David requires Zadok to anoint the new king in his stead, Solomon, and Zadok continues on with Abiathar, the other priest, to rule and reign over the temple and the services during the reign of the son, Solomon. Hello, homies. What are you doing tonight? Homies, babies just came in. I'm glad he's here, because otherwise he'd be criticizing me on the internet. So the Zadokite dynasty continued to reign, and we find out that the house of David married into the house of Melchizedek, making all of David's descendants thereafter through Jotham also descendants of Zadok and Melchizedek. So we see a coming together of these two families, the priestly family as designated by Yahweh, and the monarchical family too. That would mean anybody coming down in that line becomes eligible to be a high priest or a king. We look now to 2 Kings 15:32. In the second year of Pekah, son of Remaliahu, sovereign of Israel, Jotham, son of Uzziahu, sovereign of Yehuda, began to reign. He was 25 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Yerusha, the daughter of Zadok. And he did what was right in the eyes of Yahweh. He did according to all that his father Uzziahu did. So here we have the coming together of the families. We have this king Jotham, that was a righteous king and was commended by Yahweh through the writings of the kings. His mother's name was Yerusha, the daughter of Zadok. And what this means is that we've got, again, a double inheritance kind of anointing on all the generations, the kings, that is, after Jotham. So through the time of the captivity, the priesthood was continued. We know this because we learn from the book of Ezra that he came back as a leading Zadok, as a Melchizedek, where it says so in his genealogy in Ezra chapter 7, 2. He's in the direct line. And evidently he is the one that is sent back to start up the worship of Yahweh in the house of Yahweh again. Ezekiel prophesied concerning the temple here, its institution, the latter days, and its priesthood in Ezekiel 44, 18. Very important. He brought me by the way of the north gate to the front of the house, speaking of the temple. And I looked and saw the esteem of Yahweh filled the house of Yahweh, and I fell on my face. You shall set your heart to the entrance of the house with all the exits to set apart place, and shall say to the rebellious, to the house of Israel, thus said the Master Yahweh, O house of Israel, enough of all these abominations of yours, that you brought in sons of a foreigner, important, uncircumcised in heart, important, uncircumcised in flesh, very important, to be in my set-apart place to profane it. These were the exact thing that the people complained about in the first century regarding the high priesthood that was there then. The very things. They were bringing foreigners in. They were bypassing circumcision in accordance with the teaching of the Pharisees. They were uncircumcised of heart, which means they were not keeping Torah. They were unrighteous, and they kept the house full of unrighteousness, as we read in the histories of Josephus. Let me continue on. You did not guard the charge. Guard is the word netzer. You did not guard the charge of that which is set apart to me, and you have set others to guard the charge of my set apart place for you. Thus says the Master Yahweh, no son of a foreigner, uncircumcised in heart or in flesh, comes into my set apart place, even any son of a foreigner who is among the children of Israel. Do you remember Acts 21 that Paul was accused of that very thing, of bringing Trophimus into the temple and causing a riot? Well, we read about that riot also in Josephus, and it's very interesting to note what he says. He says that Paul and his brother started the riot, that they started the riot by going out and beating people and bringing people to riotous living, stealing and looting. Now, I don't know if that's our Paul or not. It doesn't sound like him exactly. But anyway, these were the very things that upset the crowds of common people, because the temple priesthood of the time was so absolutely lax and so in the pocket and in the pay of the governing bodies, the Herods and the Romans. Ezekiel continues, and the Levites who went far from me when Israel went astray, who strayed away from me after their idols and became a stumbling block of crookedness to the house of Israel. Therefore I have lifted my hand in an oath against them, declares the Master Yahweh. But the priests, the Levites, the sons of Zadok, who guarded the duty of my set-apart place when the children of Israel went astray from me, they shall draw near to me to serve me and stand before me. And the important word in the next session, the standing man idea, which we're going to see over and over again. So what happens here in this declaration by the Master Yahweh is that a certain family is again set apart for the ministry, worship, and service of the temple, a service and worship that Yahweh commands and that he enjoys. It shall be, he continues, when they enter the gates of the inner courtyard, that they put on linen garments. Important, linen, U.S. Eames. Are you out there at the Goodwill looking for linen garments? I am. We're going to start wearing linen around here. Wouldn't that be great? You should think about that.
Dance like David dance.
They shall have linen turbans on their heads. I'm looking forward to that. I've got one at home. I bought one from Rachel. You know her? Zipporah? That advertised seat seats and Hebrew uniforms. I bought a turban. I wore it one time. It's linen. Not that fine linen of sissies. I mean, this is the hard linen, the kind that Essenes wore. It's really cool. They shall have linen turbans on their heads and linen trousers on their bodies, and they shall not gird themselves with sweat. It also said in there that they shouldn't wear wool.
This is Florida. You can't help but sweat.
Well, do you wear wool?
I'm Scottish. Yes, I wear wool. Of course I do.
Even out down here in this heat? Well, I've seen you sweat. I mean, you should wear linen. You too, homies.
Look at his chin and ask that question.
That's right. Well, Commander Lee has got a beard and hairstyle now that, well, you probably seen him on the picture. He is a competitor in the Karl Marx lookalike contest down here on the left side of the city. We go from there, from the Ezekiel passage that predicts, to the end of the age. The priesthood of Zadok being the one that is the efficacious and approved one of Yahweh. So we follow the line of Zadok from Melchizedek to the high priest in David's time to Ezra, and we go to Yaakov and Yahshua, James and Yahshua, finding that they are Davidids and Zadokites through the line of Yotham, son Ahaz. And we find that out in Matthew 1, 9. There's a reason for Matthew to write that into the genealogy that we would not normally get unless we trace this line a little bit. That tells us that if Yahshua's line was such that it was approved for priesthood or kingship, then James as well, his line. In fact, if you believe like many do, that Yosef wasn't really the father of Yahshua, we can also believe for sure that he was the father of James, and chances are Yaakov was an older brother from an earlier marriage of Yosef, and I'll tell you why I think that, and I'm sure of that, in just a minute. So, if this was not so, then why would the family of Yosef, the brothers of Yahshua, the descendants of Yahshua, James, Jude, and Shimon, be called forth before kings and even emperors time after time? They were called before the Herods. They were called to Rome. It's even recorded that the grandchildren of Jude, the brother of Yahshua, were called up to see the emperor in Rome, Domitian. Remember, he was the killing emperor of Jews and believers, Nazareans. Why? It was because his whole family had converted. Everybody in Rome was converting at that time, and he was a very strict high priest himself, the emperor Domitian, and his goddess was Minerva, and he would authorize Minerva to be worshipped as the head of the Roman pantheon. And when this upstart Yahshua came along and was even seen in Rome by the historian Suetonius, even names him, he says that the whole city is stirred up by one Crestus. There he is. Now Jude's grandchildren up before this murdering emperor, who probably killed Josephus, his stepbrother, probably killed Paul's secretary, Epaphroditus. Yes, I think he did. He had Epaphroditus, Paul's secretary, killed, because Epaphroditus was the one that stuck the knife in Nero's head. Did you know that? That Paul and Nero shared a secretary, and that the secretary is spoken of at length in Paul, and that same secretary served Vespasian, and then Titus, and then Domitian, and Domitian finally had this guy executed because he was the one that helped Nero commit suicide. Think of that. That Paul's something else. He runs with a great crowd. Sharing a secretary with Nero. He must have been at some of those parties, huh? Like on that movie Quo Vadis. You see on Quo Vadis, 1951, with Robert Taylor and Deborah Kerr. Greatest movie you'll ever see.
But, the Toga parties?
Well, yes. Paul is in the highest echelons of the government of Rome. And, of course, he's gentle, Paul. He goes around and tries to convert everybody and tries to take him over to listen to Peter preach. And he tries to convert the Romans and so forth. But it's quite a movie. You ought to see it because there's some truth to it that, yes, Paul was very close to Nero. Close enough to have the same secretary. Anyway, I'm off the subject. That's three other seminars I did out there on the site if you want to listen to that and waste your time. So where was I? Oh, yes. Remember that the leading Zadok brought bread and wine to Abram? In the training manual of the leaders of the Yaakov Yahshua movement of the first century, known as the Teaching of the Twelve, or if you've heard this title, Didache, purportedly written and or used by the brothers of Yahshua in the Yerushalayim assembly, that bread and wine was still commanded to be offered in this earliest of Nazarene texts, calling the wine the vine of David, the vine of David, to commemorate the first Zadok mentioned in Scripture, the Davidic dynasty that was lost, and the fact that the family of Talmudim were descendants of the family prophesied to be high priests forever. Have you read the Didache? Early Nazarene discipleship training manual. You can go out to veroyahad.org, pick up a copy of it, or in the Yahad site files, and also, wow, somebody brought an offering up. Hallelujah. Is that for your friend? Okay, great, great. Got another taker of the New Testament code here. Good book. But anyway, what was I saying? Where was I? Chris? I know you weren't listening anyway. I forgot. Anybody there know what I was talking about?
The Didache.
Oh, yeah, thank you, thank you. We did four sessions, going through the Didache closely. It was written for any simpleton to read and understand. Half of it talks to the new Talmud about what it means to be a Nazarene. And the second half talks to overseers, mavakers, on how to follow the way and do the various practices. It's very good, and it's a simple thing to start. If you want to be an Essene, if you want to be a Nazarene, and you want to cast off your old ways, then get the Didache. You know, you can even do better by buying it. I've got my translations from the Greek. We don't have the Aramaic part of it. But it's very good. Some of you have got it and have been part of that study. Anyway, although the Zadokites ruled the Yahwist Elohist faith for 700 years, they were no longer in the high priesthood business and hadn't been in the time of Yahshua for 150 years. Why not? This is your host, Jackson Snyder, with an announcement. Next week is Nazarene Israel Week. I'm not talking about the new movement. I'm talking about the old movement. We're going to go back to the first century, and we're going to ferret out those first Nazarenes and their lifestyle, their practice, their theology, and their experiences. Be with us next week on Jackson Snyder Presents for the First Nazarene.
scriptures, histories, and companions of the First Nazarene. We will uncover the long-hidden ancient books, and we will read them. We will discover the intimate stories of our ancestors, the Nazarenes, and we will recount them. And those brave souls who established our faith, people like the brothers and sisters of our Savior, we will name them, many for the very first time, and they will be strangers no more. This is your host, Jackson Snyder of the Netzari Yahadim. For more information about the First Nazarene, join us at theyahad.org, theyahad.org. Until then, we hope you will enjoy each broadcast of The First Nazarene.
Hello, friends, and welcome back. This is the continuation of the training in the opposition priesthood of first century Israel, the raising up of the poor priests with the help of the people in order to take back the priesthood from the unholy, perverse family of Annas and Caiaphas. In progress.
Why not? The problem goes back to the time of the Maccabees and Hanukkah. By the way, I might add at this point, I didn't take time to make a strong connection between James and Yahshua and the Zadokite priesthood and the Dead Sea Scrolls. I didn't on purpose because I've already done this. If you're interested in that connection, go out to the website there where the downloads are and look at, there are two sessions on the Teacher of Righteousness, the Spouting Liar, and the Wicked Priest in the text called the Habakkuk Pesher in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Probably the most important text there for our understanding of Nazarene Israel and the Essenes. So if you want to get into that milieu, go out there and listen to those couple lessons. They're about 45 minutes each. So we're going to go back in time a little bit. How's the time, as a matter of fact? Okay, I'm doing good. The time was about 167 B.C. With the success of the Maccabean Revolt after the desecration of the temple by the little horn of Daniel 7:8, that is Antiochus Epiphanes, also known in the scripture of Epamenes, which means madman, the king of the Seleucid Empire. Did you know that Daniel has been fulfilled? 7 and 11? The mystery is history. You can find the fulfillment, if you'd like, in the histories of Josephus, his antiquities, and in the two books of the Maccabees, first two books. That tells the whole story of what happened to the Zadokites. In the Maccabees, though, there's a code word for Zadokites in there. They use the word chasadim. Chasadim. So if you're reading 2 Maccabees and come across chasadim, we're talking about the Zadokites there. It tells us in 2 Maccabees that the Hasidim went in with the Maccabees to cast out the Greeks during that rebellion. But then after that was done, the Maccabees turned on the Hasidim, who were the rightful high priests and their followers, and massacred them. So they were probably just a little bit mad about that whole thing. So there was a split there in Israel right after the Maccabean revolt was successful. Judah, son of Matthias, son of Hasmon, defeated the Mad King and the Seleucid Empire. Now, we call them Hasmoneans because that first, the grandfather of the big man, Judah Maccabee, his name was Hasmon. So when you see Hasmonean, it's the same thing as Maccabee, this family of five sons that came forth out of nowhere to defeat the greatest army in the region. Now, that war lasted 3.5 years, a time, times and half a time. culminating in the rededication of the temple and the legends of the miracle oil. Remember the oil that lasted 8 days, they found one cruet, to do the rededication of the temple. And let me see, what did they say? A miracle has happened here. That is the motto of Hanukkah. Hanukkah meaning the dedication, of course. Yes, sir?
Where is that in the Maccabees?
What?
That story.
It's not in the Maccabees.
Oh.
It's in the Mishnah.
Oh, it's in that thing.
Yes. A great miracle happened here. But the dedication did happen.
Of course.
In fact, one cool thing about 2 Maccabees. In 2 Maccabees, it starts out with two letters. The first is a letter from the Jerusalem temple to the temple I'm going to talk about in a minute in Egypt. The temple that was started by the Zadokites after they were massacred. Some of them went into Egypt. And the head of them went to the king, and the king said, yes, go ahead here in Egypt in Cairo, build yourself a temple unto Yahweh. So there was for a long time, 250 years, two temples to Yahweh. We just don't know much about the one in Egypt. In 2 Maccabees, the first letter is Jerusalem inviting the Onion temple in Egypt to keep Hanukkah with them in commemoration of that great battle where half the Zadokites got killed. So it's a very cordial letter. It's kind of a let's get back together kind of thing. And there's a letter back from Egypt. The second letter comes back to Jerusalem, also very cordial. The interesting thing about this is that the Jerusalem letter calls Hanukkah the Feast of Tabernacles. They had replaced the Feast of Tabernacles in Jerusalem with Hanukkah. And Hanukkah became the Feast of Tabernacles in the month of Kislev. Is that so strange? When the Maccabees took over the temple and cast out the Zadokites, they, in the second generation, they invited the Greeks back in and accepted the Greek calendar. So when the Zadokites left, they took the calendar, the Zadokite calendar of Yahweh, which is a solar calendar, with them. The ones left behind took up the Greek secular business calendar. And of course, the Greek government reinfiltrated the temple in a great, great way until it was the Greeks that just third generation Maccabees was on the payroll of the Greek king, the son of the guy that had come in and desecrated the temple. You should know that because everything changed. And by the time of the temple of the first century, they were not keeping tabernacles anymore, except in Kislev. They were not on the calendar of David or the calendar of Melchizedek. Some people think that today, well, we've got to be on the calendar of the Sadducees, because that was the calendar of Israel in the first century. Some say we've got to be on the calendar of the Pharisees. Some say we've got to be on the calendar of the Essenes. To me, the only thing important is to be on the calendar of Yahshua HaMashiach, and he would be on no other calendar but the Zadokite calendar, and doing the Zadokite way in accordance with Ezekiel the prophet in Ezekiel 44. But that's, I've got the commander here has got his eyes up in the air because he's still a loony solar. But I'll tell you what.
Just look up. That's all you have to do.
He's just loony. He's just loony. I'm solar. He's loony. That was a good joke, wasn't it?
Yeah, I'll give you that. Yeah.
All right. The whole of this great war is recorded in Josephus' Antiquities in the Wars of the Jews, 1 and 2 Maccabees, and other places, and in a symbolic way, in Daniel 7 and 11, because that's what those two prophecies are talking about. You can follow the prophecies with history right down to the end. Within a couple generations, as I mentioned, the Maccabean throne of Israel became completely corrupted with Greek money and Greek gods and Greek holidays, and went back into the bondage of the empire for the sake of money. through a plot between the empire and a traitor in the temple crowd named Simeon, Onias III, the last of the Zadokite high priests, was murdered. His brother Jason, to the Greek king, and paid the Greek king to put him, Jason, whose name was Yahshua, by the way, he changed his name to a Greek name, Jason, to put him in as the high priest in place of his murdered brother. He said, I'll do business with you. I'll take care of you. And that was the beginning of the corruption of the temple at that time. Soon after the Feast of Tabernacles in 153 B.C., Jonathan Apphus, the last of the Maccabean brothers, took on the ephod of the high priest, breaking the prophetic word of Yahweh in Ezekiel 44, teaming up for the first time not only with Greece, but Rome. This is where the first contact with Rome is made in 153 B.C. by the Maccabees, wanting Rome to come in and help them to fight with Egypt. That was the end of the Zadokite priesthood, at least in the temple. The son of Onias III, by the way, he was the fellow they called Honi the Circle Drawer. He's the guy that could draw a circle in on the ground and stand in the circle and make rain, just like Yahshua drew a circle on the ground and stopped rain, and like James was known to have done, to be a rainmaker and a stopper of rain. And there's even another priesthood I want to tell you about next week that'll probably blow your mind concerning these guys, that we find hidden away in a code name, surname, or an alias in the New Testament. So Onias IV escaped. He was just a teenager. And as I said, he went to King Ptolemy in Egypt, and he asked if he couldn't build a new Yahweh's temple, and that was about 154 B.C. And I quote, Onias IV, who enjoyed the favor of the Egyptian court, succeeded in elevating Egyptian Judaism to a position of dignity and importance. A large number of the able-bodied Judeans had accompanied Onias to Egypt, and these strangers, as they were called, received, on condition of performing military service and preserving the internal peace of the country, tracts of land on which to thrive. Other of the Zadokites and their followers went the other way into the desert of Syria to watch and pray, seeking again the true paths and making a way in the wilderness. For this, we now have to start on the Dead Sea Scrolls, because that takes up the story. That puts the next link in the chain. For these scrolls are the very writings of the Zadokite priesthood crowd, who left the land in order to sojourn in dry places, like the children of Israel before them, seeking out the will of Yahweh. Here's a little story from the scroll called the Damascus Document. I want to read a little bit of it for you, because it gives some of the story of what happened here. And notice toward the end, and yes, I'm going to finish up here in a minute. Toward the end, as in the rest of the scrolls, the writer of this scroll, Damascus Document, or CD, calls himself and the group of sojourners in the wilderness sons of Zadok, Benim Zadok. These were the Zadokites. It's very hard for scholars today to make that connection. They say, these are false Zadokites, or they've taken the name of Zadokite. They just won't take these scrolls at face value. And they want to date these scrolls 150 years before they were actually written. So to keep the scrolls out of Christianity and rabbinic Judaism altogether. That's one of the beauties of what Eisenman has done, because he has single-handedly been able to show us that certain of the scrolls not only are to be attributed to the first century, like the one I mentioned before, the Habakkuk Pesher, you really need to look at that, Teacher of Righteousness, Wicked Priest, Lion Spouter, because they're identified in the first century. Heisenman has brought this forward to the point where his colleagues now will not even speak to him. They despise him. Why? Because all these guys that have written books about the Dead Sea Scrolls have done it under an old consensus paradigm, where these things were written way back in the Maccabees' time. When Eisenman comes along and proves, without a shadow of a doubt, that some of these, like the Pesherim, are written in the first century, and he even purports to prove in this little volume, copyright about 1989, last chapter, that James, the brother of Yahshua, is the righteous teacher. He does prove it. He proves it beyond a shadow of a doubt. Now, I don't know how far into this you guys are, but if that's a possibility, then we've got to look at the scrolls with a whole lot more seriousness, because our foundational documents maybe aren't in the New Testament, which has been picked over by Catholics and Reformers and Marcionites and everybody else in the meantime, to the point that they're hardly recognizable from the earliest New Testament, the Sinaiticus, that maybe we need to get under that crust and see what's under that. That's what I've been doing lately. Been listening to the Damascus document. I've been listening to the community rule over and over. I read these things and make audios of them so I can keep them going all the time so they'll sink in. The Pesherim, the beautiful Psalms, Psalm 8 of the Dead Sea Scrolls, you compare it to the Epistle of James. Now, it's just amazing in what he says about himself. This guy is revealing himself to us through the scrolls. And as I said the last time in one of these things, James the Just is resurrected in 1997. All of a sudden, he's come alive again, and we know a lot about him. All right, a little bit from the scrolls. Well, actually, this is quite a bit. I don't know how much I'll do, because I've got the audio online if you go out and listen to it. Listen, all you who recognize righteousness. My internet connection just went out. You think that was the devil? Listen, all you who recognize righteousness, Zedekah, Zedekah, and consider the deeds of Elohim. When he has a dispute with any mortal, he passes judgment on those who spurn him. But when Israel abandoned him by being faithless, he turned away from them and from his sanctuary, and gave them up to the sword. And when he called to mind the covenant he made with their forefathers, he left a remnant for Israel and did not allow them to be exterminated. The era of wrath, 390 years at the time he handed them over to the power of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. Understand that that's a code. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, he is talking about the king of the Seleucid Empire. The scrolls are full of code words that you have to be able to figure out if you're going to make any sense of them. He took care of them and caused them to grow from Israel and from Aaron, a root of planting, to inherit his land and grow fat on the good produce of his soil. They considered their iniquity, and they knew that they were guilty men, and had been like the blind and like those groping for the way, Hadarek, the way, 20 years. But Elohim considered their deeds, that they had sought him with a whole heart, so he raised up for them a teacher of righteousness, Moreha Zadok, to guide them in the way of his heart. He taught to later generations what Elohim did to the generation deserving wrath, a company of traitors. These are the ones who depart from the proper way. That's the time of which it was written, like a rebellious cow, so rebelled Israel. Hosea 4. when the man of mockery appeared, who spit lying waters upon Israel. He led them to wander in the trackless wasteland. He brought down the lofty heights of old, turned aside from the paths of righteousness, and shifted the boundary marks that the forefathers had set up to mark their inheritance. So the curses of his covenant took hold on them. Because of this, they were handed over to the sword that avenges the breach of his covenant. For they had sought flattery, choosing travesties of true religion. They looked for ways to break the rules. They favored the fine neck. They called the guilty innocent and the innocent guilty. They overstepped covenant, violated Torah, and they conspired to kill the innocent. For all those who lived pure lives, they loathed from the bottom of their hearts. So they persecuted them violently and were happy to see people quarrel. Because all this, Elohim became very angry with their company. He annihilated a lot of them because all their deeds were uncleanness to him. Now listen to me, all members of the covenant, so I can make plain to you the ways of the despicable, so you can leave the paths of sin. Notice, paths of sin is the opposite of the way of righteousness spoken of in both the Gospels and in Acts. Elohim, who loves true knowledge, has positioned wisdom and intelligence in front of him. Ingenuity and true knowledge wait on him. He's very patient and forgiving, covering the sin of those who repent of wrongdoing. But strength, might, and great wrath in the flames of fire, with all the malachim of destruction, will come against all who rebel against the proper way and who despise the rules, until they are without remnant of survivor. For Elohim had not chosen them from ancient eternity. Before they were created, he knew what they would be. So he rejected the generations of old and turned away from the land until they were gone. Now what he's talking about there, and I'm leaving out, are the stories of Genesis chapter 6 and First Enoch. Enoch was, of course, one of the most, if not the most popular book, maybe second most popular after Jubilees among the Zadokites of Qumran. All kinds of copies of Enoch and Jubilees were found there. Two books, of course, are very, very close. And they believed in an origin of evil very much like that in the book of Enoch, which everybody seems to love these days, but nobody seems to understand the context of the book. So what they're saying, in a way, is that the Nephilim came into all these people in Israel, people that were supposed to be righteous, and turned them. Okay, I'll just go on a little more. He knows the times of appearance and the number and exact times of everything that has ever existed and ever will exist before it happens in the proper time for all eternity. They believe that. Things were preordained and set out to happen like they do. And in all of these times, he has arranged that there should be for himself a people called by name, so that there would always be survivors on the earth, replenishing the surface of the earth with their descendants. Understand, there's a double entendre here. People of the name are also people of Zadok. That's the name they were all known by, the Zadokites. They're also known by the name Yahweh, or however you want to pronounce it, you go right ahead. In the scrolls, the name is prevalent everywhere.
Well, my time's up now, so I guess we'll have to finish this opposition priesthood stuff tomorrow. Hope to see you then. In the meantime, if you have comments, questions, or you'd like to get on this show, just get in touch with me through Hebrew Nation Radio. I think my email address there is jackson@hebrewnation.net, something like that. Appreciate you all. See you tomorrow. May Yahweh be with you.
This is your host. Thank you for listening. I hope you've enjoyed our variety show, Jackson Snyder Presents. This is a presentation of the Vero Essene Yahad in Vero Beach, Florida. If you would like more information about today's broadcast, email jackson@hebrewnation.net or visit hebrewnationonline.com. Until we meet again, may Yahweh keep you safe and close to home.